I think you can start. Go for it.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the town council chambers for the town of Wethersfield. My name is Jeff Bridges. I'm the town manager. This evening, tonight, we're going to hear from Mayor Bronin about his thoughts on the city of Hartford. In a moment, I'm going to introduce Mayor Montaneri, who will then introduce Mayor Bronin just a little bit about tonight's meeting. What we're going to do is, again, Mayor Montaneri will introduce Mayor Bronin. Mayor Bronin will speak for 20 to 25 minutes, and then we'll go into kind of a question and answer period. During that time, we'll move a portable microphone to the aisle, and we would ask that people come up, speak into the microphone. That way it is recorded, and we are televising this so we can replay it on the local cable station. So when we get into that Q&A portion of the meeting, what we'll do is we'll put the microphone in the aisle. If you do wish to speak, please come up to the microphone. Ask your question, and you'll get a response. So that's kind of the format for this evening. At this point, I'd like to introduce Mayor Montaneri of the town of Wethersfield.
Thank you, Jeff. I just want to identify members of elected officials from the local town who are here tonight from the council. Mike Hurley, Mike Rell, Tony Martino, and Anthony Spell, I think he's in the back floating around somewhere. From our board, Bobby Granato, chairman of the board, Polly Moon, and Diane Fitzpatrick are here. And our legislative representatives, Russ Morin, is here, and Tony Guerrero. I want to thank them for coming out. I just want to do a quick introduction before I turn it over to Mayor Bronin. I want to share that since the discussion has started in member towns around the greater Hartford area, there's been a lot of helpful feedback and thoughts being provided by residents throughout town. I'm sure many members of our council have gotten emails and opinions. And one of the things I really appreciate about Mayor Bronin coming out is that this begins another piece of what I would hope is a greater dialogue about the challenges that we face as a state and certainly challenges we face at Wethersfield. I think those of you who have sort of seen how we've led the last years know that we have worked hard to have a broader interrelationship between the state. We all know the state has some very difficult challenges, over a $1 billion deficit that's facing. And as your mayor, I believe very strongly that we should be part of the dialogue. We can choose to sit on the sidelines and not participate in the challenges that the state faces, and some of the challenges will be answered with decisions that we may not agree with and would not have as large a role in crafting. I believe we should have a role in crafting the solutions, not only for the state, but obviously for our town as well. Those of you who live in Wethersfield or observe know that we have a healthy town. We have a fiscally sound community. We know that we have done some good things with our business community over the last several years, some of that with the help from the state. And we are interdependent with the state of Connecticut. $9 million every year in educational cost sharing. When we finished our high school this year, we're just about done, over $40 million of reimbursement coming from the state to allow us to have a flagship high school. Our representative, Russ Morin, and Tony Guerrero were involved in soliciting and getting help for us when we hit the asbestos and PCB issue 2 years ago that cost us $10 million. That project would have stopped without their help. So I share with you as I look at some of the things that we have done and continue to do as a town that I understand the interrelationship between Wethersfield and our other communities. For the record, I think I've shared this before, I do not support taking taxpayer money out of Wethersfield's pockets and bailing out Hartford. I know the mayor is here and he's going to speak tonight about several things. That's not the solution, in my opinion. But I do think one of the solutions is a greater dialogue with our community and with all communities about how the state can be healthier, how we can share resources, and we can work the way we have in the last year and a half with our regional mayors to talk about solutions that increase economic development, bring businesses to our community, and recognize the interrelationship. I'll share one thing with you. Last year when we were working on two of the larger projects for redevelopment with corporations that visited our area, they were looking at redevelopment opportunities in Glastonbury and Wethersfield, Newington. They were looking at Hartford. It was very important for them to understand what was happening in Hartford, in our capital city. I will share with you that a bankruptcy of our capital city would negatively impact the likelihood that those businesses would come to Wethersfield. I can tell you that that would impact the whole area. And I believe there are solutions that prevent that from happening if we work together. So I want to be clear on our position locally, but I also want to tell you that Mayor Bronin, who I've come to work with the last year and a half, come to respect a great deal, who's out there, frankly, going out and being public and taking the initiative to talk with the resident communities that he knows we have a relationship with. He's impressive. He's inherited, obviously, a significant challenge in the city of Hartford. Many of the problems he is saddled with, he has nothing to do with getting, but he certainly has taken the initiative to solve. So I know that this community and those that are here from within and for out Wethersfield will appreciate the opportunity to hear from him. I will also share one last point. I grew up in Hartford. Like many of you that probably moved to Wethersfield in the 50s and 60s, I remember a Hartford of great magnitude. Great shopping, retail, G Fox, Corvettes. I can remember being left at Corvettes as a 7-year-old that could be left there all day safely. You wouldn't do that anymore anywhere in Hartford probably, but the point being that Hartford in its greatness got depleted by economic change and malls and shopping and retail meccas that changed the whole platform of how the city, and now it's back on a revitalization. I believe that Hartford is coming back. I know young adults are moving there in great numbers. Developers that I'm working with have completed projects in Hartford and filled those apartments, young adults coming in. So I think there's reason to be optimistic. But it's in that context that I want to share with you that having the opportunity to hear from Mayor Bronin tonight is, again, a part of this greater dialogue. So I know you'll welcome him tonight and welcome the opportunity to hear from him.
Thanks very much, Mayor Montaneri, and thanks to everybody for being here, to all of our elected officials, Representative Guerrera, Representative Morin, to the local officials. Really appreciate you coming out, and it's terrific to see such a packed house. A few people have asked, you know, why am I doing this? And I'll talk a little bit why I'm doing this. But to me, the fact that this draws a crowd like this, whether you agree with or disagree with some of the things I say, is sort of justification for having these conversations. You know, these are important issues, and I think they're issues that we've all got a stake in. So I'm glad to have the chance to talk to so many of you here tonight, and also just want to wish everyone a happy New Year and hope that you had a good holiday season with family. As Mayor Montaneri said, a lot of folks in Wethersfield have roots in Hartford. I would bet if we took a survey in this room, a whole lot of people, either your families or maybe yourselves, were rooted in Hartford at one point. And our communities are still deeply tied together, you know, maybe more so than almost any other two towns. I was looking at it today, and one out of every four residents of the town of Wethersfield works in the city of Hartford. That's a lot of interdependence and a lot of interconnectedness, not to mention the emotional ties, the regional reputational ties, as you said, when you're doing your economic development work. You know, folks who are coming out to look at us from the outside, they don't necessarily see us as Wethersfield and Hartford. They see us as a region as a whole. So that's why I think it's important to talk all together about the shared challenges that we have. And, Mayor, as you said, we've got some big ones. We've got some big ones as a state. We've all been hearing a lot about those, and we have some massive ones in the city of Hartford. So what I wanted to do tonight was just to talk a little bit about where we are from a fiscal standpoint in Hartford, how we got to this budget crisis, what we've done so far to deal with it, and why, as much as we will continue to not shy away from any hard decisions and be willing to do whatever needs to be done to get our own house in order, why ultimately it's going to take a bigger discussion at the state level about how we put cities like Hartford in a position to be successful and in a position to get on the path to health. So I'll talk a little bit about all three of those things, but then I really look forward to a conversation and just a discussion with all of you. But before I do that, I do want to pause on something that you said, Paul. You know, If you look at cities around the country that have had revitalizations, where things have begun to turn, where places that were facing economic hardship and budget crises actually turned the corner and started to come back, whether you're talking about a Pittsburgh or, you know, an Austin or a Charlotte or a Des Moines or an Indianapolis, you know, all those places, there are a lot of common factors. And so before I get into the challenges, I just wanted to talk about some of the things that are happening in Hartford that make me optimistic about what we're going to be able to do to strengthen the whole city of Hartford and will help strengthen the region. You know, we've got next year thousands of students coming downtown at UConn. You're going to have the old historic Hartford Times building brought back to life and bringing thousands of feet on the street. You've got residential buildings that were recently vacant, dilapidated commercial buildings like the old Bank of America building that's now filled up with residential units and leased up faster than anyone expected, showing there's a demand for living in urban centers. And soon after that, you've got commuter rail. It's going to connect us tightly together. It's going to be great for the relationship between Wethersfield and Hartford, but it's connect all of us onward to Hartford, to Springfield, Hartford to New Haven, and then on to New York, and if Massachusetts gets their act together, on to Boston. So those things are all in the works, and they have the possibility to really bear fruit, to help make Hartford turn the corner in a way that's going to help revitalize the whole area. But that stuff's only going to bear fruit if we can get this foundation fixed, because the foundation is broken. And there's no question that the city of Hartford has made mistakes in the past, and I'm the first to say that. One of the reasons I ran for mayor is that I was really frustrated with decisions that had been made over the years and that were still being made. For example, I don't think we ever should have built a baseball stadium. I don't think the city was in a position to do that. I didn't support it. But, of course, you got to play the hands that you're dealt, and you can't leave a half-built stadium there. So we're doing everything we can to get that done without putting more taxpayer dollars on the line. The city over the years before that borrowed too much for many years. And then, even worse, you know, restructured that debt, like refinancing your home, but did it in a really dangerous way where they bought themselves a few years but at the price of a mountain of debt that we're walking into right now, where our debt payments triple in the course of about 3 years. The city years ago, you know, 15, 20, 30 years ago, entered into contracts with some of our unions that I think if anybody had a crystal ball and saw what the growth of the city would be, they would have known that we couldn't support it. But they did. They didn't have the crystal ball, and they entered into those contracts, and we've got to deal with those obligations. So all of those things are mistakes that I wish we had a time machine could correct, but we don't. And the truth is that as frustrating as those mistakes are, the biggest problem that underlies all of that is not those mistakes. It's the fact that we've got a system in this state, you in Wethersfield and we in Hartford, that asks municipalities to run themselves almost entirely on the basis of the property tax. Now, we get plenty of assistance. There's no question about it on education and other fronts. But our only real source of local revenue is the property tax. And I know that's a burden for your residents just as it is for ours and just as it is for our businesses. Our property tax rate in Hartford is now 74 mils. That's double what it is here in Wethersfield, and I don't in any way belittle the burden that your residents face. But for our small businesses especially and our mid-sized businesses, that's just a crushing burden. And the reason that the taxes have gotten that high is that in this state and in this system where cities have to run themselves on property tax, you've got a city that actually has less taxable property than communities like Glastonbury or West Hartford or even about the same as Farmington and less than Manchester. So you've got a city that's many times the size of those suburbs and has a totally different set of obligations, both because of the type of institutions that are in Hartford, because of the level of poverty that's in Hartford, because of population density and just pure numbers of people, a totally different set of responsibilities, but less taxable property. And that's resulted in this situation where we've got to try to fight with our hands tied behind our back. Because if we raise that tax rate above 74, last one out, turn out the lights. You're not going to have a city that can thrive and be a vibrant center of employment, which matters to every community, including maybe especially communities like Wethersfield. And on the other hand, you've got a city that, despite the mistakes made in the past, is not running with a lot of fat. it's a lean government right now. In this past year, we cut out just about $20 million of spending in this 1 year. Put it a little bit in perspective, 15 years ago, the city had about 2,000 employees. Today, we have 1,300. That's a big difference. And the things we cut this year to save that $20 million, they weren't things that didn't matter. I mean, we cut things like Dial-A-Ride for our seniors. We cut our senior centers. We cut our library. We cut arts and cultural events down to the bone. We cut organizations serving the neediest among us. Not cuts that we wanted to make, very painful and very real. But we knew we had to do everything we could to try to get our house in order. So we did those things. We've also been fighting hard to try to get our labor costs down, just like every community. You know, we're negotiating hard, and we just got a pretty remarkable deal with our fire union, which I hope will set the model for some of our others, that saves millions of dollars next year and also makes some really big long-term structural changes down the road. In front of council tonight, there's a resolution to move our non-union employees onto a 401, onto a defined contribution plan, so that as we look to the long term, we can try to avoid passing on the same kind of long-term obligations to the next generation. Those are some of the decisions that we've made, and we're going to continue to make the really tough ones. But the reality is that as much as we're willing to make tough cuts, and as much as we are willing to take on any political fight that's going to help get this our city, any internal political fight that's going to get this city on track, just as you can't tax your way out of a crisis like we've faced when you got a 74 mill rate already, you can't cut your way to safe to health when you've got a city facing budget deficits of $50 million and $70 million and $90 million looking out at the years ahead. You just can't fill that gap without cutting so deeply that you stop being a city that can deliver basic services. So that means we're faced as a city with the task of saying, on the one hand, we're going to continue to do everything we can. But on the other hand, we've got to have a conversation at the state level about how we help to build a system that actually gives a city like Hartford a fighting chance of success. And that's where you get to this question of other sources of revenue. And I want to be clear from the start, I'm not coming here and asking Wethersfield to write a check. And I'm not asking for your property taxes to offset ours. But as we look at a state that's in fiscal crisis, I think that crisis should force us to have some conversations about whether there are things we could do to help make all communities a little bit less reliant on the property tax. For example, should more revenue be diverted from sales tax to all of our communities? Should we finally fully fund the pilot program? That's called the payment in lieu of taxes, where the state is supposed to reimburse communities for the non-taxable property that they've got, but hasn't come anywhere near fully funding that obligation for a long, long time. If they were to do that, if all we did was get the state to say, all right, we're going to recognize that when a city like Hartford has so much of state government and hospitals and universities and the trash-burning power plant that takes care of the trash for 70-some towns, and the MDC, which is the sewage treatment plant and some of the most strategic land in the city, and the airport, and on and on and on, if we're going to have all those things concentrated in the city of Hartford, and none of those things are going to pay taxes, then let's build a system that reimburses the city for it. If we do that, that gets us almost all the way towards a solution. And by the way, if we did that statewide, that would help Wethersfield too. You've got state property here. You've got, I probably don't know all the state property here, but you've got the DMV, you've got, I think, DECD, you've got labor. You've got some significant state presence here. So there's a way to have this conversation that isn't just about the city of Hartford, but that recognizes that right now, our capital city is in crisis. It's in crisis because of the system that we've built and we've maintained for a long, 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 long time. And it's in crisis because of mistakes that are made in the past that, like it or not, we've got to deal with today. So my commitment to you, just like my commitment has been to residents of Hartford, is to run straight at this, is to not be afraid to make tough decisions, is to not be afraid to make tough cuts, is to not govern, you know, based on whether I'm going to get reelected a few years down the road, but to focus on one mission alone, which is to try to get the capital city healthy. And I deeply believe that if we do that, it's going to be good for the whole region. including this town of Wethersfield, oldest town in the state, which has so much tied up with ours. Let me say one last thing before I turn to the questions, because I really what I love about these discussions is to actually have a discussion. But Mayor Montanari mentioned bankruptcy. I believe, as he does, that bankruptcy would be the wrong choice for us to make as a state for our capital city for a whole lot of reasons, and I'm happy to talk in more detail about it. But he talked about one, which is the reputational impact on us as a region and us as a state. You know, if you look around the country at those places that are growing, it's those places that have strong, vibrant urban centers at their core. Those are the places that are winning jobs, that are getting companies to stay and to move, the places that are getting, you know, young people and mid-career to come and say, it's where we want to be. And if we want to compete with those, we got to have a strong, vibrant urban center that can help be that engine of growth. If we instead let our capital city go bankrupt, we're going to be on the front page of every news around this country as the first state in the country with its capital city to go bankrupt. And that's going to make GE moving to Boston look like a little pebble in the pond compared to the boulder that gets thrown in and creates waves for us that's going to last for a long, long time. So instead of saying Hartford made its bed, let it lie in it, instead if we say, yeah, there were mistakes made in the past, but some of this is the system that's been built. And instead of saying we can all hide within our borders and not worry about what happens to our next door neighbor, we say, hey, we have a chance to all advocate for something that makes sense for our state as a whole, then I really believe that we could take advantage of all those good things that I talked about at the start and start to recapture some of that energy, some of that economic growth, some of that vitality that used to be what defined this capital region. And if we do that, soon enough, we won't be talking about billion-dollar deficits up at the state because we'll actually be growing. And that's the difference between us and the states that are beating us right now. We're not growing. They are. We don't have cities that are serving as engines of growth. They do. So that's my quick opening thoughts on where Hartford is, why we are where we are, and what we can do about it. Now I'd love to just have a conversation and, you know, and any topic that you want to discuss, I'm happy to discuss. But I really want to just thank all of you again for taking the time to come out. I appreciate it. So.
Good evening, Mayor Bronin. My name is Joe Sawyer, and I have a wife who grew up in Hartford off of Signy Street, so we do have a Hartford connection. And I want to thank you for coming to Wethersfield. You have a lot of courage, and you show leadership, and I respect that. And as you said, I did some research. I went online to find out what the mill rates were of towns in Connecticut, and you do enjoy the highest at $74 per 1,000, okay? Wethersfield has nothing to brag about because ours is 38 mills per 1,000, and our sister town, Rocky Hill, is 29, so Rocky Hill is doing better than Wethersfield. So we all have to be cognizant of our finances and how we manage our towns and our cities and our state. And as you said, you know, your grand list is 50% less than what our grand list is. You don't have all those businesses, but you do have profit, you know, for-profit colleges there that might offer some assistance to Hartford. For example, Quinnipiac in Hamden, okay, they're giving over $1 million to the town of Hamden to help support their police department because they've got some students that live off campus that get a little bit rowdy sometimes, so the police have to go out there and quiet them down. But if you look at the demographics, large towns, large cities have the highest mill rates. And why is that? Because you have the most municipal workers than the small towns. So, I mean, that's where your, you know, your largest cost is in your municipality municipalities. Now, our sister city, Providence, okay, similar to Hartford in terms of, you know, demographics, they have more fire people than police. And the thinking, you know, when they did the study, they said, gee, you know, firehouses were built around mills 100 years ago. Well, we don't have any mills anymore. So my question to you is, okay, do we need all the fire companies that we have in Hartford? Do we need all the police departments in Hartford? Because those are what we describe as fixed costs, okay? So I go back and I say, you know, perhaps Hartford should do a study as to whether or not they need all these, you know, fire companies. And obviously you're going to need some legislative help, okay? We hired a superintendent from Wyndham here many years ago when I was on the Board of Ed, and he said that the legislature, Wyndham could not support the Board of Ed, you know, the education in town, so he had to go to legislature to get funding. So you need to go to the legislature, okay, and get more funding, because we can't let Hartford default. We just can't let Hartford default. But there has to be a caveat, okay? We have to make sure that we've explored all the things we can do to reduce costs, okay, and all the things we can do to redevelop Hartford, okay? And, you know, we talked about regionalization. Well, you know, MDC, I'd consider regionalization. We're all, you know, Wethersfield's part of MDC, and, you know, we're all sharing in the costs of the new pipes and all that, and we're also concerned that perhaps if Hartford doesn't pay for, you know, their share, we're going to be stuck paying for it, okay? So you know, I just, you know, as you say, you know, we're all in this together. One of the things that Rhode Island is doing, that Connecticut can do to help the communities, Rhode Island is now taxing summer rentals, 8%, okay? You know, these are funds that perhaps, you know, if we taxed rentals, summer rentals in Connecticut, okay, there's some funding there that could be redistributed to the towns, especially cities like, you know, like Hartford. So I guess I don't really have a question per se other than what I just told you.
Sure.
And I think you've really got some challenges here. And again, I thank you for coming out.
Thank you. There's a lot there and a lot of important points. So I'll do my best to hit a number of them. I may not catch all of them, but a few things. You know, starting with where you started, because you were talking about Wethersfield and Rocky Hill. It's an important point. You know, it's an important point that you have two communities that are in a lot of ways very similar, but you've got different mill rates. And one of the reasons for that is that you happen to have a lot of commercial development in Rocky Hill, whereas here in Wethersfield, a lot of it is borne by the residential homeowners. And so that gets to one of my points before, which is that really, should that determine, you know, how much a city can spend to deliver services? And that should that determine how much residents have to pay? Or should we look at diversifying the sources of revenue that municipalities have so that it's not all about how many big box stores you've been able to develop? And maybe you can develop in a way that suits the needs and the preferences of a community more. I don't mean to get too far down that road, but I think it's a important point that in some ways fits into that broader discussion of trying to reduce the reliance on the property tax as the sole source of local revenue, because it does lead to a lot of strange consequences and differences between communities. You talked about the institutions like institutions of higher education, colleges. I don't know if I just misheard, but I just do want to make sure to correct. I mean, our colleges are not for profit; they're nonprofit, which is why they're non-taxable. And I have engaged in the conversation with them about asking for contributions to the city. And believe me, that's a conversation I'm gonna keep having. There are places where colleges and universities make a voluntary contribution, and I hope that I can get ours to do it.
Oh, isn't Trinity a for-profit college?
No, they're nonprofit. Yeah, but Trinity, UHart, and soon UConn, of course, they're all nonprofit. Same goes for the hospitals. You know, they are nonprofit entities, so they're not, all that property is non-taxable. But I'm having conversations with them too, and I hope that we can get them to contribute. But again, even if we can get them to be part of the solution, it's only a part of the solution, because we're talking about gaps that are so big that I think you're going to have to try to piece it together from a lot of different places. But ultimately, you know, they're going to have to be some pretty big chunks that probably are going to have to come from a broader source, which is why you got to have that conversation on a statewide basis. You asked about police and fire. I will say a couple things. I actually think our police force is too small. You know, our police force not all that long ago was 500 officers. Right now it's about in the high 380s. That is obviously down a lot from where it was, but it's also about 100 officers below where an independent study done a couple of years ago said that it ought to be to make the city as safe as it should be. So I wish that we had room to reduce there. I think actually if we really want to get the city to a place of health and growth, there's nothing more important than public safety, so we've got to be recruiting. For a while, we're just going to be recruiting to stay in place because we have a lot of officers retiring. We've got to recruit just to keep the numbers we've got. On the fire side, there's, you know, I think discussion to be had, although, you know, I have to say my thinking's evolved on this a lot over the last year. I thought, as you did originally, that there was a lot of room to reduce. There's one of the things that surprised me more than anything else in this job is the number of active fires that our firefighters have to fight. And there's a lot of reasons for that. One, you've got a very old housing stock. Two, you've got a lot of large buildings, some of which are old. Two, I mean, sometimes this comes with the level of poverty in some places. You have, you know, electrical wires that are not that are kind of jerry-rigged and not done all that well. But we had, over the course of just this year, 500 people in the city of Hartford displaced by fire. It is an extraordinary burden and job that our fire department shoulders to try to respond to that. And so I actually think that, you know, trying to get savings the way we just did, which is by working with our firefighters to get them to help us fundamentally change the costs of, you know, of those personnel, the personnel costs, as well as the long-term benefit cost, health and pension, is the way to go. But those are a few of the thoughts. I know there were a lot of other pieces of your question, but hopefully that covers the main pieces.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Right. Evening, Mayor. Evening. I'm Paul Kopp. I'm also the chairman of the Independence Party. Jeff, may I interrupt for a moment? We have 10 chairs back there that other people could be sitting at, the elderly, and there's some more chairs in your office and in that conference room. Do you think we could get them and get
them? Would like to sit.
I beg your pardon? Oh, everybody can go and sit back there. Okay. I have been following you in the Hartford Current and the Rare Reminder and others, and I brought a few notes to ask you and to ask some other people here. First of all, why are we here in the council chambers in Wethersfield? About what? What are we expected to accomplish? Who invited you? Who is paying the expenses for this recital? My guess is this was organized by our mayor, who was in this very chamber at a regular council meeting, chastised a Republican council person who voiced an opinion that Hartford had to bail out their own financial crisis. As published in the Hartford Current, our Democratic mayor, seated here, immediately strongly rejected the GOP position, saying it showed an extremely unsophisticated view of government. Well, we knew immediately what our mayor meant. I don't know if I knew, and the question is, are we talking about sophisticated government like in Bridgeport, like Mayor Perez ran in Hartford, like in Waterbury and others? Those were very sophisticated views of government. The Democratic mayor of Hartford has been going to many of our towns. You're telling your tale of woe. Big bills, not enough stuff to tax, not enough cash from Malloy, and you have got many names in the same position as the mayors of New Haven, Waterbury, Bridgeport, all in first class on the Connecticut Titanic. At Simsbury, we received his only passive response from a very strange select person, and I think you remember her. West Hartford also had a recital for you. Perhaps Rocky Hill best exposed him to reality to you. You said that you are counting on legislators to send you money next year. Two state representatives and a state senator were present. One of the representatives is here now. The state senator informed you, and this is a quote, "I have to be straight with you. We are not going to come up with money for you. That is as straight as you can get." Do you understand that? I mean, we all did. Didn't have to say it. You know, you claim that there's just too many untaxable properties. But there were the same number of untaxable properties 5 years ago. Nothing has changed. Only the spending of the money has changed.
Can I get a chance to respond to some of that?
Let me kind of finish. These are just thoughts. What is obvious is that you have no plan. You go hat in hand and beg. Have you no shame? Yes. Have you no shame? You're an embarrassment not only to yourself, but to the people of Hartford, among which are business executives of our major corporations. And yes, they are finalizing plans to move. I've talked to them. And you do not have a year. You may have 3 months, 6 months. You must contact businessmen who have expertise in the area. I'm talking about a plan that you can formulate. And there are not many, because it's very complex. You should go not hand in hand to us, but to someone like Tom Foley, who has the expertise. If he is not interested, he may refer you to others. Prepare a plan that we can talk about. And as a Rocky Hill resident is reported to have said, you should not be looking to us to solve your problems when you should be solving them. When you're not solving, you are bankrupt. There's no question about that. When you get your hand, this is he speaking, not myself. When you get your hands on money, you're going to spend it like a drunken sailor.
You can solve your plans. Let me respond to some. Let me respond, because I suspect there are a lot of people who love a chance to ask some questions and talk as well.
There's a lot of people that don't agree with me, but there are a lot of people that do agree with me.
So let me just respond to the last point first.
Okay.
Get hands on money, we're going to spend it like a drunken sailor. I think actions speak a lot louder than words.
Okay.
Actions so far, since the year that I took office, don't support what you said. Because what we've done instead is make really tough decisions that actually treat taxpayer dollars like they matter.
Yes.
We've made some dramatic cuts.
Yes.
Cuts that were politically perilous cuts.
That is not what the gentleman
said.
I didn't
interrupt you when
you
were talking,
money,
sir.
You don't have any money to spend.
Sir. Let me take the baseball stadium as another example. As you know, as I said before, not as something I supported, but something that we've got to want to get done once the city's borrowed the money and you got a half-built stadium. I was also determined to make sure that we did it in a way that treat taxpayer dollars like they mattered there. So when it became clear that we had a developer who was expecting to come back with his hand out for another check from the city of Hartford, instead of doing what a lot of governments do in a lot of places and say, okay, let's avoid the risk, let's avoid the heartache, and we'll just write another check and keep this going, we said, no, you don't get to screw the people of Hartford. So if we're going to do business with you, we're going to hold you accountable. So we fired him, we took that risk, and in the end, we got an insurance company to step up and bear that burden. We negotiated a deal that I would challenge you to find a labor deal that made as many significant changes, both in the near term and the long term, as the one we just finalized with our fire department. I give them a lot of credit, our firefighters, a lot of credit for stepping up and being part of that solution. So the one thing I will not do is spend money like a drunken sailor. I treat taxpayer dollars like they matter because they do. Number two, I think the fact that you've got a room this full is a reflection of the fact that people understand this conversation matters. And I don't ask anybody to agree with me. I just ask to have a conversation. I appreciate that you think this conversation shouldn't be happening and we shouldn't be having it here. I don't know where you think we should be having it, but I will just say I appreciate the fact that we've got a room that is packed to standing room only because folks understand that no matter what you think about the solution, the problem is real and it matters to all of us. Now, let me keep going. You talked about a plan. We have a plan. The plan is, first and foremost, to keep doing everything we can do to get our own house in order. Now, that means starting with the kinds of changes that we made that I talked about. It means continuing to work with our labor unions to try to get those long-term changes that get us on the right path. It means not making the same kind of mistakes that have been made in the past. But it also means not kicking the can down the road and not doing things that get us out of crisis today but just make it worse. So, for example, could we raise taxes 10 mils and have a mill rate of 84 and deal with some of this problem for next year? Yeah, we could do that. But then you're just bleeding a city to death. And then we're talking once again about being in this same situation a few years down the road with an even less healthy city. So part of the plan is actually to say, hey, wait, let's press pause, everybody, and let's take a minute to recognize that what we're doing doesn't work. And if we want to build a city that can help be the heart of a region, then we can't keep doing what we did in the past, which was find short-term solutions to what is a serious long-term problem. So those are some of the thoughts that I'd have, but I appreciate your coming and appreciate your comments.
Good evening, Mayor Bronin. I was a Hartford resident for many years, over 20 years, and my parents still live in Hartford. Is this even on? I sympathize with you. I know Hartford's decline is not your fault, and you're trying to change things. But it seems like I'm wondering, and a lot of people are wondering, what can we do for you? I know there's plans of you're hoping for regionalizing and shared services, but those would only save you, it would be like a drip in the bucket as far as savings to you. 50 million, 70 million, 90 million, that we can't help you with that. That is just too much money. Now the state, I heard in the paper, they don't even want to give you all the money for the payment in lieu of taxes money, and that would help you greatly. I think the state should support you. The state, you're in the state's front yard and backyard. That's where the state is, and they want their own neighborhood to where they legislate to deteriorate. It's a shame. I don't really see how the surrounding towns could help you. So one of the previous speakers mentioned the MDC, and that concerned me because we have a contract with the MDC, and it's not regionalism, but it was sort of a contract where the surrounding towns are in with Hartford as far as the sewer bills and water bills. Now, Hartford couldn't pay their sewer bills. I think you were able to come up with half the money.
So just to pause on that, we have paid our. There's no bills that we've missed.
Oh, so
the reason the MDC thing came up is part of the conversation about what happens if we don't, as a state, figure out the solution to this, and what happens if the city of Hartford ends up going down the road where we actually do declare bankruptcy. At that stage of the game, then
we would have
creditors potentially don't get paid. And in that situation, MDC is a creditor. So I just want to make clear, we haven't missed any payments, and we don't want to miss any payments. I mean, our objective is to take that whole issue off the table by actually getting the city of Hartford on a path to health where we don't have to have that conversation. But it's an important issue because, I mean, that is part of the genesis for how some of these community conversations started out. The MDC issue is one that affects everybody because that is probably the one way in which we are all most obviously tied together. My hope is that we never have to have a conversation about Hartford not paying its bills to the MDC because we're able to build a system that actually helps get the city healthy.
Well, the last time MDC was here, they said that Hartford was not able to pay, I guess, half their bill, $5.5 million. The surrounding towns, from our contract with the MDC, are required to cover the difference. If one town can't pay, the surrounding towns have to pay. So that means all the others, Wethersfield, West Hartford, Bloomfield, all the surrounding towns have to pay. Now, you're telling me that you're going to pay, But next year, with $70 million, the year after, with $90, how are you going to pay?
Well, I'm saying it's one more reason that I think all of us, including a community like Wethersfield, should not be too eager to see Capital City go bankrupt. Because one of the effects of that is potentially that we can't pay our bills to places like the MDC. And that has real consequences for everybody. So that's all I'm saying there. Now, in terms of your question of how do we avoid that, you already offered the solution. If the state were to fully fund its pilot payment, the payments in lieu of taxes, that would get us almost all the way through dealing with this crisis. Now, let me pause for a second and talk about the payments in lieu of taxes. So a long time ago, the state adopted a policy in statute that said that the state was going to reimburse communities a certain amount for non-taxable property, right? Whether that's state property or hospitals, universities. The state has not fully funded that for a long, long time. The other thing is that the current formula, the way it works is state property, which you guys have, is actually reimbursed at a much lower level than all other types of nonprofit property. So colleges and hospitals are supposed to be reimbursed up here. State property is supposed to be reimbursed down here. They're all actually reimbursed down here. If you brought state property up, equalized it, which again would be good for Wethersfield, and then you fully funded that formula, that would produce $70 million more revenue to the city of Hartford. That would be the bulk of the way to getting us to a healthy city. And I think there's a strong argument for doing it, strong policy argument, strong moral argument. When you've got a city where you've concentrated all these nonprofit uses, again, so much state property. Again, the MDC, the trash-burning power plant over at what was CRRA, the airport, the hospitals, the universities, a lot of the social service agencies that serve the entire region. You've concentrated all of that in the city to the point where more than half the property in the city is non-taxable. We are fighting with one hand tied behind our back. So to fully fund that is one solution. Now, I'm the first to admit that's a real challenge at a time when the state's facing its fiscal crisis. And I don't pretend to have all the answers. I only want to make sure that that's part of the conversation. Because at the end of the day, I really believe that fixing the fiscal crisis for our state is about getting our state growing again. And to get our state growing again, you got to get your employment centers healthy.
Now, you said you hope that that's going to be the solution. I hope it is, too. We have some state reps and senators here that maybe they'll listen carefully, but I think that's the only solution because we can't bail you out of $50 million,
yeah.
$70 million.
You and I are saying the same
thing. Nothing Wethersfield and surrounding towns could help you with that debt. That is just too enormous. So unless the state decides to intervene, you're going to have to go bankrupt.
So let's talk about bankruptcy for a second, a little bit more about bankruptcy. I talked about one piece of bankruptcy, which is the reputational impact that would have and the what I think would be the body blow to our economic development efforts in this state as a whole and in this region. But there are other pieces. What does bankruptcy for a municipality do? You know, bankruptcy for a municipality is not like a bankruptcy for a company or for an individual. You don't just get to walk away from all your obligations because most of your obligations are ongoing. You know, you still got to have a police force. You got to have a fire department. You got to have a Department of Public Works. You got to have a finance department that can actually function. You got to have the basic services and the basic functions of municipal government. So what bankruptcy does is it really targets three areas for municipality. One, it opens up your union contracts, so you renegotiate them. That doesn't mean the court just imposes the terms. You still have to go through the same collective bargaining process, the same negotiation that you would otherwise. Number two, bankruptcy potentially takes money away from retirees. It reduces people's pensions who are already retired. And number three, it potentially targets your creditors, your people who hold your debt, and drops that down. So let's talk for a second about all three of those things. Our union contracts are actually all open right now. So we don't need to crack them open, and cracking them open is not a great thing to do. But you don't need to because they're actually open right now. We're negotiating hard. Number two, when you look at retirees, here's another example of the ripple effect that would have. There are hundreds of Hartford retirees living here in Wethersfield. Hundreds right here in Wethersfield and thousands in the region around. And although if you read the paper, you see some pensions that are look just exorbitant and are as frustrating and obnoxious to me as they are to a lot of people, the truth is that a lot of the pensions that people are living on, they earned long ago. They haven't been adjusted through cost of living adjustments. They're enough to meet the bills. And so you're talking about a lot of middle class residents of a place like Wethersfield or other surrounding towns who are going to get hit in a pretty painful way if we go down that road. And third, you go after your creditors. There's where you also get that effect that that we talked about earlier, where all of a sudden that's not just about Hartford, because people can see that Hartford's not the only Connecticut city under pressure. That becomes about Connecticut's health as a whole. And all of a sudden, just like the MDC's borrowing costs have gone up, all of a sudden borrowing costs for other communities start to go up too. So there are real consequences beyond what I think is the biggest, which is the reputational hit to all of us. There are some real consequences to everybody and every one of our communities of us going down that road. So that's why I believe we've got to have the willingness to say, look, here are the choices. We either figure this out on a statewide basis, or we're going to be going down a path that isn't good for anybody, least of all for the long-term growth of the state, which really has got to be the answer to all these challenges we face.
One more question. I heard on the radio recently on AM radio about the mayor from New Britain has all these innovated strategies to get themselves out of debt, and it includes tax redistribution, negotiating benefits. Is Hartford, I know Hartford's trying to do that. They should have done it a long time ago before we gave these great benefits to the municipal workers, pension plans, and put ourselves in this debt, and all these nonprofits you say that Hartford has. Well, who allowed those nonprofits to come into Hartford? The previous leaders of Hartford.
No, I would say it's not the previous leaders of Hartford. I mean, nobody can stop, you can't yeah. stop them from
yeah,
coming
I know
in.
I know it's not your fault. I know it's not your fault, but it goes back to the point I was trying to make is and like you said at the beginning, Mayor Montaneri said, we do not want to increase our taxes to bail you out. So that brings the point up, what can we do for you without bailing you out or increasing our taxes to help you?
So I appreciate the question. I'm not going to give you a satisfactory answer, because I do think that this is about developing a statewide system that makes all of us less dependent on the property tax, and that recognizes that when you have this much non-taxable property, you just can't make it work. When you have a city with such a low amount of taxable property, you can't make it work. So as the legislature, and I don't envy our legislators' challenges this year, they've got huge ones, as they are facing massive challenges, which, by the way, are not their fault either. It's the fault of the fact that for decades the state didn't fund its pensions. That's one of the biggest reasons. As they deal with those challenges, I just want to make sure that the strength of our capital city is a part of that conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor Brown, my name is Dan O'Connor. I live here in Old Wethersfield. And first, thank you for acknowledging Wethersfield is the oldest state in Connecticut. I hope this is being played in Windsor. and I'll also, not only being the oldest state in Connecticut, we also have the oldest volunteer fire department in the state, in the country. And it's an incredible volunteer fire department. And in this conversations of regionalism and working together and working as one and all the other descriptions you've given on that, Wethersfield residents aren't allowed to apply for a job in Hartford to be a fireman. Are you going to change that in this cooperative type of agreement?
So, I mean, let me say a couple things. First of all, you don't need to be a Hartford resident to be a firefighter.
So you need to be one to apply for the job.
I know what I'm saying, when you apply. But the truth is that, you know, the majority of Hartford firefighters don't live in Hartford, right? Let me say, now talk about a couple of the others. 93% of our police officers don't live in the city of Hartford. The majority of most of our administrative workers don't live in the city of Hartford. I don't plan to change the requirement that you live in Hartford to apply to be a firefighter for a few reasons. I mean, one, the city of Hartford, unemployment is about triple in Hartford what it is in any of the surrounding towns. We've got neighborhoods in Hartford where unemployment is worse than it was in the Great Depression. It's awfully hard to say that when we have the ability right now to say, look, to compete for this job, and we got, by the way, 700 applications for what's going to end up being a fairly small number of fire positions. There's a lot of demand out there. I want to do everything I can to encourage employment for Hartford residents. But I will say again, the vast majority of employees in most of our departments actually live in surrounding towns, which means most of the taxpayer dollars in Hartford are going out to other communities, just as the vast majority of retirees who are paying pensions to live in surrounding communities rather than in the city of Hartford.
And first, I'll tell you, I appreciate you being direct and honest on that. I completely disagree.
I understand.
But I appreciate you being, and that's fine, and I hope that's what this whole thing is all about.
Exactly.
The other thing is, but we are talking about regionalization. And when you talk about regionalization, it goes both ways. And I can tell you, as a parent of children in the school system, when I hear regionalization with Hartford and I hear the possibility of sharing resources and possibly Hartford having involvement in the education of the children of Wethersfield, and I'm not going to sit here and debate with you on that, but that's something I hope you have an opportunity to talk to. And what is your thoughts on that?
Okay.
Because that is a concern for me, and I know it's a concern for a lot of people.
Yeah.
A lot of people in that area.
Okay, so let me talk about that for a little while. The gentleman who spoke earlier talked about rightly about the fact that sharing services is not the solution to Hartford's fiscal challenge, and that's exactly right. And I am not claiming that it is. The solution to Hartford's fiscal challenges are those structural discussions that we had before, things like the payment in lieu of taxes for nonprofit property. That said, I think Hartford's challenges are the most severe. I think the challenges we face are probably the most advanced in the state. I don't think there's any question about that. But there are a lot of places that are on the same road, where property taxes go up and up and up every year, where the pressures on the cost of government go up and up and up every year. And so I think we have to have conversations as a state about how we build a state that's able to bring those costs down. It's able to provide some relief to property taxpayers. And I do think that one of the ways to do that is for us to look around the country at the way that most places do it, because most places don't take a state of 3.5 million people and carve it up into 169 separate towns and duplicate every single one of those services in every single one of those towns. If you were building the state from scratch, you would not do it that way. It just doesn't make sense. Now, you raise a really important point about education. There are some functions that I think a lot of communities are going to see is just so core to their identity that they don't want to have that discussion right now about sharing. But maybe there are other things that aren't so core to your identity. So, a great example, which is starting to get talked a little bit more and more about, is 911 centers, 911 call centers. We've got a state of, again, 3.5 million people. We have, I believe, 109 911 call centers. Harris County, Texas, which is about the same size population, I think has one. State of Maryland, I think, has three. It doesn't make sense to duplicate all of those costs. And we're not just talking about the fact that means every town has to staff up for peak demand and prepare for the most, the most extreme circumstances, but also means they're investing in really expensive technology on a regular basis and upgrading it on a regular basis, millions and millions of dollars in each one of those 911 centers. So, could we have a conversation about doing that on a regional basis, saving money, delivering the same types of service more cost effectively, maybe even better service because you'd have enough staffing that you'd never have to worry about having the peak demand exceed capacity. So that's just an example, but there are many other examples. I think we've got to face the fact that, look, there are a lot of people frustrated in Connecticut. They're frustrated about property taxes. They're frustrated about the fact that we're not growing. They look at other places where they see those challenges aren't there. All I'm saying about regionalism is we can't complain about the fact that other people are beating us, but not be willing to look at any of the things that are helping them to beat us. So let's be willing to at least have that conversation about whether we could deliver some of those core services in a more cost-effective way. But I do agree 100%, that's not the solution to Hartford's fiscal challenges. Those challenges are much bigger than that. I do think it's part of the solution to long-term getting this state to be a healthier, stronger, more competitive state.
Good evening, Mayor. My name is Catherine Mohan-Hallisey. I was born in Hartford, first-generation American. My father started in Hartford. I'm sure I share that with many people here. I'm hoping to sort of change the tenor of this conversation going forward. I appreciate you coming. I want to thank you for agreeing to take the challenge of being the mayor of Hartford. I have worked in Hartford since I graduated from law school in Washington, D.C., and came back and always wanted to make Connecticut my hometown. And I want to tell you that I have followed you. You are a Rhodes Scholar. I believe there are 1,000, perhaps another million jobs you could have besides being the mayor of Hartford. And I thank you very much for agreeing to take on that challenge, because I think that there are probably not that many jobs left in the United States as quite this challenge. But because I go to Hartford every single day and I work there, and I started my business there, and I love it there, I believe that Hartford is a shared responsibility. It is our capital. It is where we go when we are sick and we need a hospital. The major churches in Hartford, I am a Catholic, the cathedral is in Hartford, they don't pay any taxes. When we go to work every day, we want to make sure, like, I thank you very much, the roads were really shoveled great today and yesterday, and the sidewalks. And so I want to say, I actually want to figure out a way to help. I think we all have a responsibility to help. I mean, making Hartford good again, if we think about the history of Hartford and the companies that started there and the Industrial Revolution that started there, the state of Connecticut was one of the major states in the United States of America when it came to some of the greatest creations and inventions. And so I understand that we are all, I just had one of my major clients, which everyone's already talked about tonight, move out of the state of Connecticut, okay? I mean, we have a shared responsibility, the state of Connecticut, to figure out how to get ourselves back on the right road again. But that is not your fault. And so, and neither sort of, for those of us who are good taxpayers in Connecticut, can we figure out why we are in the situation we are, but we are collectively. And so I say, it is not fair to you, or it's not fair to the rest of us, to figure out how we move forward as a state, to help your city and as a town of Wethersfield. And, you know, obviously no one's going to let you pick the pockets of any town. Unfortunately, as you said, when we gave up the county system years and years, years ago in the state, we created 169 school systems, 169 municipalities, which without a doubt has cost us all collectively money over the future. So if you could figure out a way in which we could help, because obviously picking pockets of other towns and cities, obviously, as you heard tonight, it's not going to work. I will tell you, I will be the first in line to help you. You can call me up and tell me what to do and tell my business what to do. But I thank you for coming. I thank you for having this conversation. And only making Hartford great is good for all of us. So good luck.
Thank you. I obviously appreciate that very much. the one thing I will say is I love this job. I love this job because I really believe a lot of what you said about the possibility of the city and the possibility of getting the city healthy and strong and using it again as that engine of growth that it used to be for the whole region. So when you believe in what you're fighting for, it's fun to fight for it. But I appreciate you saying it.
Good evening. Tom Mazzarella. I was born in Hartford. My parents in the 60s decided to move out of Hartford to Wethersfield. My father was an educator in the city of Hartford, taught there his entire career. But he wanted to go to a better place than Hartford. He wanted better schools for his kids. He wanted better bang for the buck for properties. He wanted a better way of life. And I think he got that in Wethersfield. You say, or it's been said, that you don't want to pick the pockets of Wethersfield and the surrounding towns, but the answer seems to be to go to the state. But we have to recognize the state gets its money from all the taxpayers, all 169 towns. So inevitably, we, the citizens of Wethersfield, are going to participate in bailing out Hartford. And I don't think that's right. Yeah, it's going to be diluted over the whole entire population, but you're still looking at, you know, maybe a quarter or a half percent of the sales tax that's been kicked around. Why do we have to come up with the money to solve the problems of Hartford. And I don't know if you can comment on that.
Sure, yeah.
A lot of it's been said. I don't want to just rehash everything that's already been said. But.
Sure. I mean, a few things. You know, first of all, I don't think there's any insulating a place like Wethersfield from Hartford's failure if it fails. Again, one out of every four people in this community work in Hartford. Hartford and Wethersfield, just like Hartford and East Hartford and Windsor and West Hartford, we are, regardless of where the borders are drawn, we're one integrated economic region. It doesn't matter what we call ourselves. We are tied together from an economic standpoint. And if Hartford goes down, property values are going to go down here in Wethersfield. Employment's going to go down here in Wethersfield. Good luck getting your kids and grandkids to move back somewhere near Wethersfield. We're all tied together, like it or not. And that's why there's just no way to say, let Hartford fail, but contain the damage. That's not how regions work, no matter where you draw the lines. That's one answer to it. But let me give you the flip side of it, which is instead of the fear of failure, let's talk about the possibility of getting this right. You know, it was not that long ago that people talked about Massachusetts as Taxachusetts. And everybody thought that Connecticut was more competitive and was beating Massachusetts. And I was talking with somebody recently who was talking about back in the 70s and 80s, it was a big company that was trying to decide whether to locate in Boston or Hartford. And they didn't know which one to choose because they didn't know which one had a brighter future. If you look at Boston today, Boston is the engine of growth for the entire state of Massachusetts. Massachusetts is beating us in the competition for jobs, not really statewide, but because Boston is that driver. And the Boston Globe did a story not all that long ago, a couple weeks ago, saying, well, how is it that that happened? How did Massachusetts leapfrog Connecticut? And one of the things they said, and don't get me wrong the way I say this, but one of the things they said is that Connecticut has a suburban economy in an urban age. And what that meant is that the employers in this country today are looking to be located in vibrant centers. That doesn't mean that there's not a place for suburbs. In fact, strong urban centers help create strong, vibrant suburbs. But employment growth everywhere in this country is happening in cities because people want to be where that talent is concentrated, where innovation is shared, where there's an energy about it, where you can recruit young talent. That's what's driving growth everywhere else. And our problem is we fell behind the eight ball. We didn't realize that you have to have strong cities to promote strong economic growth. So we had so many companies that scattered in so many different places around the state. And as a state, we actually incentivized them to do it in a lot of cases. So those are my two answers to you. One, there's just no way to say, let Hartford fail, and you're not going to feel it here. And two, on the flip side, if we actually get this right, that's the solution to the challenges that the state as a whole is facing. And then you make that revenue up through growth, not just through taxes. But is it going to take some time? Yeah, it's going to take some time.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Mike Casanelli. I grew up here in town. I always taught my kids when they were very young, for every action they have, there is a consequence, and the responsibility is on them. Regardless of what the action is, there is a consequence, either good or bad. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. I'm going to put my foot in my mouth. Which party's been in charge of Hartford for the last 40 years?
Well, a lot of the challenges that I'm talking about are state policies, right? Okay. And when we've had, for a long time, we had a split governor and legislature Republican. So I don't think this is a partisan issue.
You said something before about your urban residential centers filled up with work, filled up. I was curious as to whether or not it was working folks, or if it was welfare recipients.
The residential units in downtown you're talking about?
Yes, sir.
They're mostly market rate housing, and they are mostly folks who are employed at the companies that are trying desperately to attract talent, like the folks who are living in those places now.
Okay. You said the rail system's going to revitalize Hartford. Is that the same way the busway was supposed to do kind of the same thing?
No, I didn't say the rail system's been revived. You want to? We can take them one at a time. It's fine either way.
The
state is dual tracking the rail from New Haven up through Hartford, and it'll go all the way up to Springfield.
Yes.
That's going to finally get rid of the, you know, turtle crawl that you got to do if you want to take a train down to New Haven and get down to New York, and it's going to be synced up with the train schedule in New York, so you don't have to get off in New Haven and sit there for 30 minutes to get in. So I actually think for Wethersfield and Hartford alike, it's going to be a game changer from a public transportation standpoint and linking us into some of the major population centers of the East Coast.
Saying that we're going to have a commuter rail system come through town into
right.
Hartford.
Yeah, that's what I said. But it's not open yet. It's being done right now. It's going to be in 2018 that it'll come online.
Okay. You mentioned that you cut dial-a-ride.
We did.
Don't most of the welfare recipients in Hartford have free rides with Connecticut Transit?
Dial-a-ride is a service that helps our seniors get to places that they can't go to. And now they can get there on a much more limited basis. I don't think that's a good thing.
All right. I keep hearing you say that you need to cut things. Why don't you try cutting some of the handouts that Hartford gives out?
For example?
Housing.
We don't give out housing.
No,
we don't give out welfare. Nope.
Okay.
But thank you for your question.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Barb Baru, and I wasn't born in Hartford. I was born in Jersey City. As was my father, who's not here tonight. Be grateful. I've thought a lot about Hartford. I mean, I'm a Wethersfield resident, and this is my home. When you come from an immigrant family that has lived in towns for hundreds of years and you move, it's important to put down roots. But I think about Hartford a lot, because I've always been part of an urban worship community in Hartford. One of the things that makes me crazy is we're a little state. We could fix it if we tried, but we're just way too involved politically. There's too much that is irresponsible. One of my thoughts is, what if all the state property across Connecticut was, in a sense, taxed? In other words, what we did in Wethersfield a couple years ago, we had a problem fixing our roads, and we couldn't figure out how to explain to people we needed to spend that money. We get a tax bill now that shows how much is being spent on roads. What if the state said, okay, we have $10 million worth of pilot responsibilities across the state, and everybody's going to contribute to it on an equal basis? Because there are towns that do not have state property. Wethersfield has a reasonable amount. We have DOC, we have DMV, we have the Department of Labor. That would be one way to look at it.
Right.
In terms of regionalization, I don't know what the county government did that was closed down in 1956, but we sure don't need that other level of government. We got enough government. I think that we need to look at the nonprofit sector as an asset. I sat here and I remember looking up the assessed value of the church I belong to on Woodland Street, Grace Lutheran. It's about $2
yep.
million. Dollars. Yep. At 78 mills, we'd have to pay $156,000 a year, which is more than our budget. But on the other hand, we feed 100 people 52 weeks a year.
Yeah.
We've created a company to give people a second chance called the Fresh Start Pallet Project. We should look at all of those things in Hartford that the churches do, that the nonprofits do, as positives. And, you know, maybe to use in the nonprofit sector, what happens when you go looking for grants is you say, well, this is our donor base, and this is what we get in kind. So maybe if Hartford started to look at those positives, and I think, you know, previous speakers have said, you know, who's been in charge in Hartford for 40 years or 50 years? I don't know if you've ever seen the House of Commons when they question the Prime Minister. It's
yeah.
quite entertaining.
Yeah, I have watched.
There's something to be said for the loyal opposition. There's something to be said for the folk who stand up and say, what are you doing that for?
Yeah.
Why are you doing that? And does it resonate the same way when it's the same party, I have a feeling. So maybe there should be a line for lotto tickets, because I don't think we're going to donate as taxpayers in Wethersfield. It doesn't mean we don't want to help you, but we're going to have to find a way, and maybe there's a way each of us can offer something in terms of our time and our talents.
Yeah.
We haven't got any treasures left.
Well, first of all, I mean, I want to thank you for your involvement at Grace Lutheran, and it is a church that does a lot, and I, you know, grateful for your involvement there and volunteering there. You know, I have watched the House of Commons and Prime Minister questions. As you can see, I'm not I don't shy away from tough conversations. I don't mind having them, and so I welcome as much scrutiny and opposition and questioning as in every forum, whether it's you know, at Hartford City Hall or here. And I should say on that point, this is a really important point. You know, the governor in his opening remarks at the beginning of the legislative session a couple of days ago said something. He said you know, that they're going to be, what he's going to propose hopefully will create a path that no city has to go bankrupt. I obviously was glad to hear that. He also said that's not going to come without strings attached, that there has to be accountability, and you have to make sure that any increased assistance to a community doesn't just increase the cost of government. That's a coupling, that's a pairing that I welcome. I'm not afraid of being held accountable. I'm not afraid of having strings attached. You know, in fact, this past spring, I actually went up to the legislature and asked them to put in place a sustainability board that would provide that type of oversight and accountability. So I know you didn't ask about that specifically, but to the point about, you know, not being afraid to be held accountable, I'm not afraid to be held accountable in this or any other forum. And I think you're exactly right about that. Now, the last thing I'll say is, you know, what you said was, two other things. One, I think you're absolutely right about looking at our nonprofits as assets. And so I hope you don't get me wrong. When I talk about the fact that they're non-taxable, that's not me saying that they're not valuable, right? In fact, our hospitals are one of the biggest employers that we've got in the region. You know, our churches do tremendous work helping people in need in addition to their spiritual mission. Our universities obviously help to create I think an important part of the foundation of building an ecosystem that helps generate economic growth. So all of those institutions play a really important role. Just like somebody's got to treat your sewage, and so the MDC does it, just happens to do it in Hartford. And someone's got to burn 70 towns trash, and so the MIRA does it, they just happen to do it in Hartford. Right? There is value to all of this. My only point, which is actually something you suggested, is that if as a state we're allowing all that to be concentrated in one place, then we got to figure out how to spread the responsibility for helping to make up for the fact that you've got all that non-taxable property in one place.
Well, I think the point is that towns don't think, I don't think the people in Wethersfield think about that we have all the state buildings we have.
Right.
And we don't think about Pilot. We don't think about what that would be if it was taxable.
Right.
Taxable. And there are other towns that have similar issues. And that would be equitable. But I would only say this. I don't see the governor as being a fiscally conservative individual.
excuse me. Gus Colantonio. I also was a resident of Hartford in 1962 to 1973. I have good memories. And Barker Street and Franklin Avenue. And by the way, a pleasant surprise. I was really impressed with your discussion. I really agree with a lot of things you're saying. But I also have to say that years ago, this country was built by probably or the unions. The unions were tremendously. I also believe that right now the unions are ruining this country. Years ago, you could find a job in private industry which paid a little bit more than the government jobs. But in the government jobs, you had more benefits than you had in private. Right now, it's all the opposite. You find a job at the state or local government or federal, which pays much more, has a lot of benefits, and not much accountability. We got to do something with that. Basically, you say that you have a problem in Hartford, and I think we have a problem all over the place. And you asked, or you have reduced from few years ago from 2,000 jobs to 1,300 jobs. That's good. Did we need those 700 jobs then when they were employed? But more important, what I failed to hear, I guess, or is that nobody in towns are asked to get a cut in pay. When it comes basically to benefits and whatnot, I hear that at times people retire with a bigger pension than when they were working. That's crazy. Yeah. To me, it's crazy. Yeah.
That's okay,
it's just unbelievable. Now, I am retired. I've been retired for a while, and I always come right here to the town council and complain all the time. My complaining was, I got a 0.3% increase in my Social Security. They just signed a contract for 3 years, and I guess the employees in town, they're going to get 2.2, 2.3, 2.4% every year. Where does it come from? When I bought the property right here in 1973, I used to pay $127 worth of the mortgage. Right now, I pay over $600 worth of taxes. And every year it goes up. Now, you say it's 74, 78, the mill rate, and we are 38, 39. But that's not really a good comparison, because obviously if a house right here it's worth $300,000 at 38, and a house in Hartford it's worth $150,000 at 80, we pay the same amount of taxes. You know, plus or minus, right? So the mill rate doesn't mean anything. I mean, the mill rate is based on how much are the houses worth.
Until you go to sell your house.
Yeah, until you go and sell the house, yeah. But, I mean, you know, obviously, you know, in Wethersfield, it seems to me that, you know, we always play around with the mill rate. Yeah. But if my house now, you know, I bought it for 40, and it's worth 200, I'm paying a lot of freaking taxes, I think. and it doesn't go anywhere. I mean, you know, really, where does it go? The unions have made this country, but now the unions are going to ruin it.
So let me just say, you know, you said, you never see anybody take a cut in pay. So I mentioned that we're negotiating now with all of our unions. And I talked about the firefighter deal. Our firefighters just took a cut in pay. They took in this contract that they just agreed to not just 4 years of zeros, 4 years of no increases, but beyond that, they dramatically increased the amount that they're paying towards their pension contributions. They increased the amount that they're paying towards their health care. They got a high deductible health care plan, which is coming out of their pocket. So effectively, they just took a cut in pay. In addition, even for active, you know, it's a lot of times you'll make a deal and it'll be different for the new employees than it is for the existing employees. Existing employees in this contract actually extended the time they have to work till they can hit retirement, which not you don't hear that all that often. So I will just say that what you said you never hear of, we just did. I will say also that the first thing I did when I took office was take a $20,000 pay cut, personally. But we are working as hard as we can to try to do exactly what we just did in our negotiations with fire across the board, because we know that we've got to do everything we can to get those costs down. But again, we'll come back to the size of this. What I was seeking in this year's budget was about $15 million in labor savings. Those are big. To achieve that are big changes with people taking big cuts. That would have only gotten us $15 million of the way through the $50 million deficit that we faced this past year, and we would still be facing $35 million deficit next year and 51 beyond. Every dollar counts, which is why we're fighting hard for it. But my only point is that it's important to stress that what I hope I stressed earlier, that I'm not suggesting that we're not going to do tough stuff. We just want to get help. We know we have to have help, but we're going to do everything we can to do our part from what we've, the tools that we've got, with the control that we have from City Hall.
And I appreciate it, because I said it was very educational. Now, let me say one point that, you know, I started working in 1971. I worked with this company for 37 years. You know what's my pension now? $77 a month, and only because we were part of another company. Otherwise, I would not make anything. Now, when somebody from government retires and they make more in a pension than they were making when they were working, there is something wrong with the system.
I don't disagree with that at all.
Thank you.
Can let me say one thing about pensions, because it's important. I mean, I don't disagree at all with what you just said, but put one thing in context. You've got to give credit where credit is due. And there are a lot of, state government for decades did not fund its pension obligations. They made the promises, but they didn't put any money aside. The same is true in a lot of local governments. A lot of local governments, Connecticut and around the country, made those promises and didn't put any money aside. For a long time, the city of Hartford actually did. And coming into the financial crisis in 2007, 2008, the city of Hartford's pension plan was actually 103% funded. It was overfunded so that for a number of years, the city didn't have to make any contributions toward its pensions. And that's one of the reasons that I think there was sort of a false sense of security when those contracts were negotiated in the past, because people felt, oh, well, our pension plan is really, really healthy. It can afford to make these commitments, and maybe we can keep our salaries a little bit lower by making these big pension commitments. Then the financial crisis came along and whacked the pension fund, and all of a sudden we're paying $40 million, $45 million a year into our pension to keep it to fund it, and it's, you know, it lost 30% of its value. So I don't disagree at all with your point, but I think it's important to set that as context, because, you know, that's one of the reasons that the city got into that position.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Leah. I'm 20. I'm a college student, so obviously I don't have the life experience that many of you guys have here. But in my degree, I'm nursing major, and we've talked a lot about different drug problems and stuff, and I go to school down in Florida, and they're talking about the drug problem in Connecticut. So obviously that's really significant. And Connecticut's also the third most lenient state for giving out welfare. So my question is, what if you did drug testing before distributing the welfare checks? Because that would significant, if somebody on welfare does have the money for drugs, then they probably don't need the welfare if they can pay for their own drugs. So if they did the drug testing and they did test positive for even THC or other illicit substances like that, then they don't receive their welfare check, and that would significantly increase the revenue of the different cities.
Yeah, I mean, so one point is important to make. It wouldn't change at all revenue to the cities, because cities aren't responsible for providing, you know, food stamps or other forms of welfare
the
assistance.
State in general.
Narcan is not all that expensive, and I tell you, it saves a heck of a lot more money to administer a dose of Narcan than it does deal with somebody who's overdosed and died as a result. Narcan is a worthwhile expenditure. The other important thing, look, this is really important. The drug problem we're facing is not a problem that stops at economic, demographic groups. It's not a drug problem that's affecting the poor and not the wealthy. It's not a drug problem that's affecting cities and not suburbs. The vast majority of people who our police officers encounter purchasing drugs in Hartford don't live in Hartford. They're coming in from suburbs. And we have to desperately, at a national level, to start taking this opioid crisis seriously and giving it the resources at the national level that it demands. But I don't think that what you suggest is going to deal with that policy problem, and it's certainly not going to change any of the fiscal issues for the city of Hartford.
In Hartford alone last year, there are over 600 drug overdoses.
Correct, but that's not necessarily Hartford residents. That's anybody and everybody who's in to use. Look, Hartford is a place where a lot of people come to buy. And again, a lot of the folks who are coming in to buy are not coming from Hartford.
But your first responders do.
Absolutely. They will save lives. It's their job to do, and I wouldn't tell them to do anything other than to save that person's life, and God bless them for it. Because that life is someone's son or daughter or wife or mother or husband or father. I mean, this is all of us. This opioid crisis, it's a veteran who served in Iraq or Afghanistan or Vietnam. This is affecting everybody. So the answer here is not to let people die when we have the tools to save them.
Hi, Dr. Sue Tenorio, a homeowner in Wethersfield and a resident of Hartford for some years. And I've also lived and worked in towns much larger than Hartford, Danbury, and Boston in particular. So I'm very familiar with the reality that you're touching upon with some of our questions, in that many of the folks from the suburbs and small towns go to the urban centers for services. Sometimes it's out of sheer necessity because it doesn't exist in small towns, but other times it's to save embarrassment. I think that's probably the biggest reason, because there's more anonymity by seeking services in a large urban center than in a small town. But I do think there are three areas that you can look at, in probably in collaboration with other city officials, because I don't think you have the authority to do it by yourself, obviously, and that is to take a very hard look at MDC's budget. It seems to be some secret from the whole state that the income and expenses of that organization, and then all of a sudden they need money from the suburbs. So I think that's one area that really requires closer inspection. Another area is, in fact, the public school system. And I know some of my best friends are in the public school system, and I work closely with many of the individuals in the school system, administrative and school staff. But there's a lot of duplication of services in the school system, and with as many superintendents who have come and gone over the years, each one comes in with his or her own administration and then does promotions from within, typically. And when that superintendent leaves, another one comes in with their own, but none of the previous administrative appointees or hirings ever go away. So there's just this continuous revolving door of superintendents without consistency and continuity and duplication of staffing. And then the third area is, in fact, to look at your own house. And I'm assuming, because you've made at least reference to the fact that you've made cuts inside, but the same principle almost applies to City Hall, in that as each new administration has come in, there have been people that have remained in place. It may be a union issue. And just for an aside, I was chairperson of the Hartford Civilian Police Review Board. And at the time that I was chair, we did a study of urban centers across the state, across the country. And Hartford had, for its size, three times the staffing of police department, its police department, than other urban centers. So I wish you well in your pursuits.
Thank you very much for all those. Let me just take the last, I think it's, I just want to make sure we touch on that. In terms of staffing, if you look at peer cities, it's not the case that Hartford is overstaffed. Again, you know, I mean, there's an independent study that I mentioned earlier that said that the right number for Hartford's police department is about 480, 482 is what they said, and we're down around 380s today. But it's also it's under New Haven, you know, and New Haven, in addition to having around, you know, more than 400 officers, they've also got a university that's got a police force of about 80 something officers, 85 officers that polices much of the downtown. So I don't think that's correct, and I just want to make sure to highlight that. You made a really important point at the beginning, which I agree with, and that's something that I have been talking about, is that a lot of these services that are provided in Hartford, not just at the hospitals, not just universities, they are regional services. Our homeless shelters, it's not all Hartford residents, folks. A lot of it's not. Our halfway houses, where the Department of Corrections places people when they get out from prison, it's not all Hartford residents. A lot of folks who are coming from other communities and are placed there, in some cases deliberately to get them out of the community that they may have come from. So it is the case that there are a lot of services delivered and provided in the city of Hartford that benefit residents of the region as a whole, and I think that's a really important point. But I appreciate your comments, sir.
Tom Fitzpatrick. I was born and raised in Hartford. My first job was for the Parks and Recreation. My father was a cop, so I've got a lot of ties. I've still got relatives that live in Hartford. I think one of the things that, if you look over the history of Hartford, you're in this mess because of bad decisions, okay? We can blame, and my concern is that I'm sitting here and I'm listening to people say, well, you know, if we could get rid of the property tax system, it would solve our problems, it would rearrange the money, and so forth. And I think a lot of people have the concern that although we may not have everything we want in Wethersfield, I think we've been fiscally responsible. And I think that goes for a lot of towns in the area. They've taken advantage of monies that they could get. You know, they've watched how they've spent it. They've looked to the future. Hartford just never had that. In the 80s and the 90s, when CROG was really pushing for regionalization, unless somebody was going to get something out of it in Hartford, Hartford didn't want any part of the regionalization. So I think that really I applaud the efforts that you've made so far. I'm not sure how far they're going to go, but I think those are the things that in my mind, and I think in a lot of people's minds, because we have control over our money. We feel like as a town, you know, again, we may not agree with everything that everybody does on the council, but at least we feel comfortable that some of the right decisions are being made. I don't think people feel that same way about how Hartford is running. So there's just so much money. So whether you decide that you want to do it on a sales tax basis, a property tax basis, my concern is that all that you're going to do is it's going to go back into the big pot, and then we're going to go down the hill from there.
Sure. So look, I think that's, as I said before, not necessarily expecting any help without strings attached and without accountability and without, you know, the need to justify what we spend. And so, you know, I think there is a way to ensure that if we get that help that helps get Hartford healthy, it doesn't just get wasted. Another way to say it is we need that money just to keep the lights on. So there's not a lot of extra that's going to be left around to waste, because we're just trying to say the gaps we're talking about are the gaps that get you back to delivering essential services at a pretty basic level. That's not going to provide any cushion to spend. The other thing I would say is I hope that my administration, although it's only been there for a year, I hope that it gives a different sense than what you've seen in the past. Because I think we've been good stewards. I think we've been tough, you know, rigorous managers. And we've put in place a team that is really strong and that's willing to be held accountable, and that I would put up with one of the best teams of any city or town in this state. It's a terrific administrative management team. They're serious. They're willing to be held accountable. They're making tough decisions, and I'm proud to have you know, brought them in. So I hope that there's a different feeling, but I understand the frustrations of the past. Let me just say this. Another way of saying, because you said we're here because of the mistakes made in the past, and I said earlier, you know, it's not all because of the mistakes made in the past. Some of it's just the way we've built this system, that you can't run a city on a property tax base that's smaller than a suburb. It just doesn't work. Right? So here's one way to illustrate it. Even with our mill rate at 74, if we didn't have a single dollar of debt, we would still have a deficit next year. If we didn't owe a single dollar towards our pensions, we would still have a deficit next year. That's how big that mismatch between the basic responsibilities and the size of our taxable property is. Another way to say it, if our mill rate was the same as yours, if our mill rate was 38 instead of being 74, you could eliminate every dollar of debt, every dollar of pension obligation, and then eliminate the entire police department and most of the fire department, and you'd still have deficits in the years ahead. It's just not built to succeed when you've got a property tax base the size of a suburb, and you got to run a city. Sure.
I understand you have a high mill rate, but part of the reason for the high mill rate is the value of your properties have gone down.
Not the commercial.
What caused those values to go down? If you went back through, I would guess that your grand list has decreased, not because of the pilot program, because all those state buildings have been there. It's not like they just moved in yesterday. So if all those, the value of those buildings have gone down, that's what's happened to your mill rate. I mean, to your grand list. So as a result, yes, I understand you have to then raise your mill rate to compensate for this drop. and who caused it, and I still believe, and it's going to be hard to dissuade me, and but I still believe that those, a lot of those were based on bad decisions. That's why people moved out of the city. That's why businesses moved out of the city.
Like I said at the start, there were bad decisions. But even if you corrected every one of those bad decisions, you still have a problem. And another thing I would say is on the taxpayers, remember that a lot of the biggest taxpayers are also the biggest employers. And if you think that, you know, the Aetna and Travelers and the Hartford and the Steam Boiler and the Phoenix and on and on and on, that they don't think they're paying a high tax rate, spend some time with them. You know, they've been paying and they've been loyal and they've been committed to the city. But they pay a lot. And I look around, I see small business owners here who I know who have operated in the city for decades who pay an enormous amount. And that's not because their property, they're not paying that mill rate because their properties are down. They're paying that mill rate full freight. And the value of their property wouldn't be all that different if it were located in Wethersfield versus Hartford. The commercial property, that's why we've seen so much flight of smaller businesses, of restaurants, of name, you know, institutions in Hartford to the suburbs, is because you can't run a smaller mid-sized business paying full freight 74 mils when you could move a mile down the road and pay 38. It just doesn't work. So there is some truth to the fact that values have come down, although that's small comfort to somebody who owns that house and is then not only paying the taxes but also seeing the values plummet. But the bigger story is, especially when you're talking about commercial property, the values haven't really gone down. It's just that the taxes have gone up. And then the last thing I'd say is the non-taxable property actually has gone up. The state's purchased more and more buildings. The state has purchased some very high tax-paying buildings recently. Nonprofits have expanded. The hospitals have expanded. There is a larger amount of territory taken up by those. So I take your point, and I hope I got ahead of it by acknowledging right at the start. If I had a time machine, there's a lot of things I would do with it. But we also got a system that is just not built to work because of the basic mismatch between what it takes to run a city, even at an essential services level, and the property tax base that you got. Yes, sir. And I know, folks, I'm happy to stick around as long as you want. It's 8:15 right now. I'm also happy to stick around and talk privately, with folks afterwards. Sir, obviously, we'd love to take your question. If there's, yours and one more, I'm happy to do it. But we should probably, out of respect for your time, we should probably start to wrap up soon. Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mayor. My name is Robert Young. I live here in Wethersfield. I have several questions, but I'd like to come back to what Tom was talking about, the valuations of your properties in Hartford. My understanding is that here in Wethersfield, they take the value of your home and it's 70%. Then the tax rate is applied to that. My understanding is also, from what I've read in the paper and I've talked to some other people about it, is that your tax rate, or I should say, you determine your gross rate to be taxed is based on 32%. Somewhat different.
That's exactly right. For residential, you're right.
We're at 70%.
Right.
So you have a tremendous amount of valuation that you could pick up times your 74% mill rate to help fill your gap instead of coming and asking us to pony.
So this is important. You're absolutely right with respect to residential. Although if you equalized the mill rate to deal with next year's gap, in other words, if you eliminated what you just said altogether and you assessed everything at 70%. By the way, it's state law that does that. It's not Hartford city policy that does that. It's state
law.
They
allow you to go 32%.
They don't allow. They require.
Do they allow us?
Nope. But let me just say this. If you didn't have that, if it was exactly the same, to balance next year's budget, you'd have 70 mills across the board, full freight. So it doesn't change the game that much without putting you in a place where you just can't let a city survive. The other thing that's important, and I do think this is important to say, median income in the city of Hartford is $29,000 versus about $80,000 here. Now, I'm not saying those aren't – I mean, the property tax burden for residents here is really big, but it is for residents all over the state. But I do think it's important to note that difference. We lost most of our middle class a long time ago. and that matters.
Yeah, it's too bad it's only 29%, but I don't know what to say about that. But anyway, I have another issue here.
Sure.
In the Hartford Current, there was a letter to the editor, and it stated that the state is absolutely making historic investments in Hartford. Since 2011, the State Bond Commission has allocated over $700 million for Hartford projects. This does not include the $120 million for UConn Health, Hartford campus, nor the $100 million or so in bonding approved this week for the state office building renovation, the restoration of the Lyric Theater, the Connecticut Children's Medical Center primary care clinic, nor the $250 million for something else. I don't remember what it was. And
probably talk about the Excel Center.
And then
that,
just
that hasn't
this
happened.
Week in the Hartford Current, I think Sunday, you got another little grant for some kind of landscape.
Let me take
Albany Avenue for $30 million, and if you pony up $1 million, the federal and the state will give you $29 million, from what the article says.
Right, 80%. So let me just take a couple. 80% of. Let's just take them in one by one. So on the last one, the Albany Avenue streetscape. First of all, keep in mind, Albany Avenue is one of the most important commuting corridors. It's actually got the highest, one of the highest traffic counts around. And if we ever redo I-84, you can bet you're going to see a whole lot of traffic coming down Albany Avenue from West Hartford and the Farmington River Valley, even more than you have. But more importantly, it was 80% funded by the federal government. Back in 2006, that money was set aside. If you think we should have turned down that deal and not put up $1 million to get 80% of a $30 million project funded from the feds, I would respectfully disagree.
Let me touch on the other ones.
You
relate to it, and I say, well, if you only have to put up $1 million to get $30 million worth of investment, and what they're saying here is that you guys need $11 million for your sewer charges or whatever that millions are, we're paying for that.
But the money. So look, I totally understand.
At the end of the day, we're paying for that.
I totally understand. Although 80% of it, you're not. I mean, the federal government is paying for it, right?
The federal government,
but,
and probably most of everybody in this room pays federal income taxes as well as state income taxes. So
I understand.
We're all paying.
But
now,
I think
also,
you're
also Mayor. You also had the sale of several properties in Hartford recently over the last several years. The Connecticut River Plaza at 450 Columbus Boulevard. I didn't hear any complaints from the City Council of Hartford, but I do know that I read some articles that you were trying to negotiate. The City of Hartford was trying to negotiate better pilot dollars for when the state bought that building, the Connecticut River Plaza, as well as 555 Farmington Avenue. And I don't know what the deal was, but because the articles do not indicate whether they got extra pilot money or not. And if they did get extra pilot money, there's something wrong here. You were the attorney for the governor of the state of Connecticut, and your fingerprints are all over those two purchases in one way or another. So, Mayor, you're on the other side of the fence now. And you're complaining that the state is not paying enough pilot money, yet when you were buying, your administration was buying those buildings, you gave the City of Hartford whatever you wanted to give them until they fought, and I have no idea what the end results are because the newspaper does not say that. Now, I also know that, not long ago, there was a building called the Xerox Building on Sigourney Street, owned by private, which now is owned by state. And you're getting pilot money for that. We had some good propping or Ponzi schemes that were going on with the prices of these buildings to help prop the City of Hartford. You've received, as I read a few moments ago, the words from the letter to the editor. That was from Benjamin Barnes, the budget manager for the state of Connecticut, because he was bragging how much money has gone into the City of Hartford. And like I say, I mentioned the Xerox building. There's other buildings and properties that were also pumped in, money that was pumped into the city. And look what our investment is today. We're looking at a city that we pumped billions of dollars into, and it's heading for, and it should go,
so,
for bankruptcy.
You're
out here begging for money, and we've put a hell of an investment into that city up there, and there's nothing to show for
it. Let me address some of these.
How much is that going to bring back on a return? Is it really worth putting that money into it? Do you have a return that we're going to get?
Let me address some of these. A certain way to make sure that those investments don't pay off is to let the city go bankrupt, because that's going to set you back years, all of us back years, in promoting this region as a hub, as a vibrant place to live. So you want to make certain that all that money goes to waste? Let us go bankrupt and let us fail. I will say a bunch of things. If I could, come 5-6 years ago, and if I could have made a choice between the state making capital investments — there's a big difference between capital investments in buildings and operating dollars that it takes to run a city. You can't use one to do the other, right? You're not allowed to use one to do the other. But if I could trade between all those capital investments and a fiscal, budgetary system that could allow you to create a healthy ecosystem in the city, where our small businesses aren't getting taxed to the teeth and leaving, where you can actually come in and start a new business and do it cost effectively, where our biggest companies feel confident that they can be. If I could trade all that capital investment — by the way, mostly institutions that don't pay taxes — if I could trade all of that for a fiscal structure that allows you to create a healthy system over the city over the long term, I would do it. What we have to do now is make sure that those investments in hospitals that serve the region, in state government that supports the region, in state buildings that were purchased that didn't benefit the city of Hartford when they were purchased, and we lost a bunch of money from the tax, the drop in taxes. If you want to make certain that all that investment doesn't help create a capital city, then say screw it, let the city fail. But if you want to say, look, we've got a city where this past weekend you could have gone to watch the UConn hockey play Yale at a pretty well attended game despite the snow. You could have gone and seen national cyclocross championships drawing people from all across the country to our beautiful Riverside Park. You could have gone and seen a world-class art opening of Elizabeth Colt's amazing collection of Japanese art at one of the best art museums you'll find anywhere at the Wadsworth. You could have gone to an AHL game and seen the Wolfpack. You could have gone to the Bushnell or to the Hartford Stage or any number of other places and had incredible cultural experience. If you want those things to help lift up and define a region and make it a place that people want to be and to grow, then don't say, let the city of Hartford go bankrupt.
But don't pull those deals off. And then as you are going down, you're asking for help. Don't pull deals off like the Dunkin' Donuts.
I wasn't here.
The Dillon deal. I know you weren't involved in it, but you are the mayor and you are responsible.
That's right.
You are responsible, and we don't give you any slack.
That's fine. I don't need slack. I don't need slack. That's fine. But all I would say is this. I agree with you. We should never have built the baseball stadium. But I'm going to get it built in as cost-effective a way as we can now that it's there. I agree with you that the city should never have committed to some of the obligations that they do, but we're going to manage them down as best we can. I agree with you that the city for too long wasn't disciplined enough, and we've changed that, and we're going to keep changing that. I agree with all those things. But the bottom line is we all have something to fear from failure, and we all have something to hope for from success.
Yeah, and in your case, I wouldn't want to be the mayor of a bankrupt company, bankrupt city either. That's probably the major reason you say you don't want it to go bankrupt.
No, let me be clear. So you just said, I don't want to hear, mayor. That's a really important point. You just said, I don't know if everyone heard, he said, you wouldn't want to be the mayor of the bankrupt city either, and that's why I don't want to go to bankrupt. That's not the reason. I mean, I proposed a bill last spring that was politically perilous like you wouldn't believe. I'm willing to take political risks. I don't care about getting reelected. I do love this job and I love this city, but I'm not going to spend every day in this job trying to figure out how to stay in the job. I'm spending every day in this job trying to figure out how to fix what could and should be one of the best small cities in this country, in one of the best small states in this country. And so that's my mission.
And with the billions of dollars that the state taxpayers have put into this city of Hartford, it should be fantastic. But I believe your management was so bad and troublesome. And many times I stood at this podium and condemned your organization. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. So I think this is the last one. Maybe. It's 8:30 now.
I'm not good at this.
You're doing fine.
No, I'm not. I'm really not.
Just step up close.
Well, I'm kind of short, so.
I know how it feels.
Ken? Okay, good. Thank you. Okay. My name is Janet D'Angelo. I live in Wethersfield. I grew up in South End of Hartford. Single parent family, so we know about working very hard from 14 years old out on tobacco fields. If you want something extra, you work hard for it. Nobody's going to give you anything. So, and I know there's many people here, I'm sure that like myself, we all have kids who have college loans we're helping with, and plus we're paying our taxes. We pay our taxes. We don't go and, ignore our responsibilities. I feel bad for you. I really do. Your position is really tough because you came into something that is not your fault, and it's a bad position to be in. I don't want to see Hartford fail. But I know myself as someone who is just an average everyday person with a job that, you know, I have increases in pay that are probably 50 cents an hour per year, and they think that that's a great raise. That doesn't cover anything. Thank God my husband has a great job. So it balances it out. Our son is a police officer. And to say that, first of all, we should cut anything to do with fire or police is ridiculous. Okay, the fact that they gave up your firemen what they did for what they do. I go to work, I sit at a desk all day. I don't put my life on the line. And when one of them, I hear any of them, anything happens to any of them, EMTs, any of them, it's a sad thing to think that you would ask them for anything. That's just my feeling. And they're here to save anybody and everybody, no matter who they are, because they're somebody's child or family member. But I just have a couple questions, and I'm not really that well-versed on politics and how things work, but I just have certain feelings about things that I would like to get your answer to. First of all, a few years back, I read in the newspaper that, and I know you said that the state is trying to help the city of Hartford. Am I correct in that?
I'll tell you in June.
Okay. Well, I read a couple years ago, I don't know if it was last year or the year before, Malloy gave out 12% increases to his staff. Who gets a 12% increase? Not your responsibility or having anything to do with you, but maybe if the state did something about what they do with their employees, and I'm not talking about the everyday worker that sits at a desk, I'm talking about the upper level people that are on his staff that got those 12% increases. Well, whoever can answer it, I'd like to know why somebody would get a 12% increase ever for any reason at all for a yearly increase. That's ridiculous. So maybe if the state wasn't so irresponsible with what they did and Malloy could cut some of the stuff he does, he'd be able to help the city of Hartford a lot more. So there's a lot of fat right there that somebody could do something about. Not you, probably. Unfortunately, you probably don't have that capability. But I'm just saying, there was a comment here about the state helping you and helping the city of Hartford. And there's things like that that are ridiculous, that certainly that money could go somewhere else. And we're talking about large salaries. Are there any, it's probably a stupid question, are there any city employees that are not union?
There are some, not a lot, but there are some.
Okay, but so the majority of them are not. So there's nothing really that's going to be a big thing you can do with reducing any of that. Because I know myself, you know, I'm not a union employee, and whatever comes your way, you either take it or you can go out the door. So unfortunately, we're all facing tough things. Like I said, you know, we all have our own personal responsibilities that we have to meet, and to be a person who meets those is not easy on some of the salaries that, you know, some of us make. City vehicles. A couple of years ago, there was also something in the paper about a guy that had a city vehicle, wasn't even on the city payroll anymore. Is there any oversight for that now?
There is. And in fact, we've dramatically downsized the fleet. We sold off a bunch of them, and we put in place some pretty strict policies on who can have them. There are some of it's actually there are some contractual issues, but it's a pretty restrictive policy now.
So you have somebody checking all those
yep.
things now to make sure that
yep, we do.
That doesn't those things don't happen. Is there a board of some sort where there's a because like I said, I'm not really well-versed in how some of the political things are reviewed, the budgets and things like that. But is there a board where both residents, and it doesn't have to just be residents of the city of Hartford, if you're asking us to contribute to something, and, you know, I wouldn't mind doing that if it would be something that's such a small increase, I'm not really going to feel. It's not going to take, you know, bread off my table. But is there a board that you have a combination of people that really look at what people are passing for budgets and what they're actually spending that money on, and not just political positions, but everyday average people that can come in and have
a say. There's not a board, but as part of the budget process, like in a lot of communities, and I assume like Wethersfield, there are public hearings and there's public discussion of the budget and opportunity for public feedback, you know, in a forum very much like this. The other thing I'll say is, you know, I to the point about welcoming accountability, you know, I asked a state board that exists, the Municipal Finance Advisory Commission, I asked them to review our finances. I asked them to come look over our shoulder.
Those people are appointed positions?
They're actually municipal finance experts from around the state. So it's people who are, for example, you know, CFOs or chief financial officers or finance directors of or town managers of communities around the state.
But
they've been put in that. Sure. Yep. Well, no, I wouldn't say they're political. They certainly don't have any political...
Well, not necessarily to you, but I'm saying there are people who, you know, because they're in that type of a job, they have...
Yeah. But, I mean, in any case, there is you know, just like in most communities in Connecticut, probably every community in Connecticut, the budget process is a public one, transparent one. It's adopted by a city council in public meeting.
But I'm saying if for some reason we did somehow contribute to this, is there any way that people in Wethersfield are going to be able to see where this money's going and where it's being spent?
If you want to invite me back, I would be happy to walk through
it. Well, I mean, you know, I'm sure it's going, you know, good places mostly, but I'm saying, is there something that somebody says, oh, gee, I can look down all the line items and see, yeah, where is this money going? How much did they spend?
Sure, the budget itself is public. Absolutely.
It is?
Yep.
Okay, all right. Okay, just one other thing I wanted to say, and I know somebody mentioned something about people getting benefits, social benefits and things, and you should, you know, maybe cut some of those social benefits, whatever. I mean, maybe there is room, because I'm sure there's some fraud in everywhere, in all of those things. It's just part of what happens. People aren't honest. But I'm just wondering if you did have some sort of, and I know one of the girls that got up here, the college student, was talking about, you know, cutting benefits to people if they weren't drug tested, whatever. That's probably a whole civil issue. But what I'm saying is, if you have somebody who is getting benefits and they're not working, and or possibly because they can't find a job because there's no jobs, maybe make them part of something that if they are able physically, they don't have young children that they have to stay home with, they're in school all day, or they just don't have children. Maybe make it so that they can become part of the community and help out, volunteer until they can get a job, and show them the way to get up, go to work every day, and be responsible people to help pay those taxes.
So, you know, one of the things we did this year, and it was something that was a priority of mine, was to create something called the Youth Service Corps, where we, all private money, I mean, we went out and raised money from foundations and from others to set up something modeled on some of the things that were done in the Great Depression. Because, like I said, there are neighborhoods in Hartford where unemployment is higher than it was in this country during the Great Depression.
Except that I drive down streets sometimes, and sometimes I'll take the back roads to come home. I hate to tell you, but I see very capable, able people sitting around doing nothing on my way home from work. And in afternoons that I've gone down that way, I do go down that way.
So what we did was we built this Youth Service Corps focused on young people from ages 16 to 24. Mm-hmm. You know, folks who have either dropped out of school, or they're disengaged from school, or they finish school and they can't find a job, and they're over 18, to get them that ability to work part-time year-round, get some work experience, and hopefully get on the path to employment. It's a critically important part. Obviously, we can't come as a city because we don't have the resources to pay beyond what we were able to build by going out and fundraising from private foundations to launch this. You know, we're not able to build something bigger than that. But my hope is to grow that. My hope is to grow it because, to me, it's not just about employment and opportunity, particularly for young people, and particularly so that we as a state can help get someone on a path to job so that we don't spend the next 10 or 15 years paying for that person to sit in prison. It's about public safety, it's about saving money, and it's about getting people on the path to employment. That's our small attempt, our small effort so far to try to address what's a much bigger problem. And that's for youth, yeah, 16 to 24. I would love to be able to do what you suggest.
Right. I'm just saying they're getting a benefit, a social benefit from the city.
They're not getting. City doesn't provide any benefits to folks.
I understand
folks.
What you're saying. Yeah. And I'm not talking about the state benefits. I'm not talking about the welfare benefits.
Okay.
I'm talking about you go to the social service agency, human services, and just like we do here. It's not a state benefit. It's a town benefit, and the town will help this person or help that person. I'm just saying, if you have people that do get help from the city, whether it even be, you know, housing or anything, and I know you said you don't do that, but whatever the city might help somebody with, if there's somebody who's long-term on something, you know, maybe get them to be part of the community and do something for what the benefit they're getting.
Like in every community, there are a lot of people who are very active in their community and very dedicated and volunteer and work hard and serve others, whether it's through their church or through their neighborhood or their block. You know, Hartford is, whether you used to live in Hartford or you don't, or you know Hartford, Hartford is still a very strong community where there's a lot of commitment to neighbors and to neighborhoods and to each other. And so, you know, my hope is that, in the coming years, we can make sure that we rebuild the city so that we start growing again, we rebuild the city so that we're strong again. And I hope rebuild the city so that we can start growing jobs again, because the answer to most of the challenges that you talked about and most of the challenges that others talked about is jobs. And if we want to grow jobs, we got to grow our cities. Thank you so much, everybody. I really appreciate the chance to be here. And I just want to say thank you again to you, Jeff, to you, Mayor Montanari, to Representative Morin and Guerrero, to everybody for coming out on a cold night.